Hey, greetings, everybody. Apostolic and prophetic models. Isn't that a great picture? That's a little clip of that sign that was on top of the church. Where was it? Yeah, it was in Verdun, Gordon Avenue. That was a great sign on top of the front of the church there. Where is that sign? I would pay big money to put that in my rec room. That would just be so cool. Hey, let's get going. You ready? Luke chapter 6, 13. And when it was day, he called his disciples to himself, and from them he chose 12, and he named them apostles. Jesus called them, and he named them apostles. Specifically chose that word, a word that they understood, a word that was used in their day, a word that had a usage and a context. Apostles, a Greek word, apostolos, a delegate, a messenger, one sent forth with orders. In their day, it was used to describe an admiral of a fleet of ships that was sent by a king to conquer new territory, but not only to take new territory, but in that territory to establish the government of the king. So it's missional and it's incarnational. It's missional that we're going to go take new territory, but it's incarnational that in that area we want to bring the culture, the nature, the manifestation of the government and the kingdom of our king in that region or in that area. So apostles, W.A.C. Rowe, out of One Lord, One Faith, he said, apostles must always be a vital subject for the Church of Christ. The pages of the New Testament are covered with it. Facts of apostleship confront us everywhere. It smites the eyes. Even a versatile imagination cannot depict church without an apostolist ministry, nor an anonymous order. You cannot have church without functioning apostolic ministry taking place in it. And I agree, it smites the eyes. If you're really reading the New Testament and going through it, you'd have to say, wow, these apostolic people, these apostles, they're very, very important. Ephesians 2, 19 to 22 says, we are fellow citizens with the saints and the members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. If you don't have a strong foundation, what you're building, it's not going to have a strong future. You need a really good foundation. Celebrate foundations. Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. It is built together for a dwelling place of God by the Spirit. If God's going to build a place where he's going to dwell and he's going to hang out, he's going to build it right, and it's going to have strong foundation, and it's going to have strong foundational ministries. Ephesians 3, 3 to 5. How that by revelation, Paul saying, by revelation he made known to me the mystery. It was a mystery. In the old covenant it was a mystery, but it's not a mystery anymore. He revealed to me, in ages past it was not known to the sons of men, as it has been now revealed by the Spirit to his holy apostles and prophets. Apostles and prophets are a significant ministry in the body of Christ then, but equally in the body of Christ today. Acts 15, 32, it says, now Judas and Silas themselves being prophets. They didn't just prophesy. These guys operated in a prophetic office. They also exhorted and strengthened the brethren with many words. Peter Land, in his book, First Apostles, Last Apostles, he said, where the church has apostolic and prophetic figures at the foundation, it is likely to flourish. For the church to flourish, it needs those ministries functioning in the foundation. I'm going to look at three models just quickly in the book of Acts, three models in the early church. And the first is Jerusalem. Jerusalem was an apostolic center. It was I call it a logistical base. It was kind of a base that was in a safer area. It was a base that was there where it had strong leadership. It had strong ministry there. Acts 8, 14, it says, when the apostles who were at Jerusalem heard, Philip went out and started ministry in Samaria, and when that happened, the apostles heard, and they went to check it out. They went to establish it. They went to bless it, and there they laid hands on people, and the Holy Spirit was imparted to people. Acts 15, 2, we go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and elders about this question. We got a question. We're here. We're wondering about this issue, and we want to go. We want to submit it in Jerusalem. Jerusalem was a governing doctrinal hub where they would take questions back to. Let's go back and let's work this out with the apostles and the elders at Jerusalem. Also in Galatians 2, 1 and 2, Paul said, I went again to Jerusalem. I got a revelation. God poured into my heart a vision. He's given given me a ministry to the Gentiles, and I'm not going to let them tell me, is it a ministry or isn't it? I'm going to submit it to them. I'm going to take the ministry God has given me, and I'm going to honor the Jerusalem church. I'm going to honor that apostolic hub, and I'm going to submit my ministry to them. So we see Jerusalem, a very, very strong governmental doctrinal base where, you know, there really was a lot of order and things were established in the Church of Jerusalem. Antioch then became a fire base. It was now something had moved out. Something was established out, you know, away from Jerusalem and on closer to the front lines. It was a fire base. Acts 13:1, it says, in Antioch, there were certain prophets and teachers. There was a group of ministers who were working together. It says in Acts 11:23, Barnabas got sent there to see what's going on. We're hearing all these things in Antioch. So Jerusalem, that governing body, they wanted to know what's happening with this apostolic hub. So the church was born in Jerusalem, but it began to mature. It began to stretch and express itself in Antioch. And when he came there, he'd seen the grace of God and he was glad. They started reaching through beyond ethnic barriers and racial barriers. They started to reach out to the Greeks. And it's the first place they were called Christians was in Antioch. But I love what Barnabas saw that excited him. He saw the grace. He saw the grace of God. I love that. Acts 13:3, and there it was in Antioch where they were praying and seeking the Lord together. And the Lord said, lay your hands on Saul and Barnabas and just send them out. Paul and Barnabas. Barnabas and Paul. Send them out into the work of the ministry. So we see it was now a sending center, a releasing center. And now Paul and Barnabas, when they finished their ministry trips, they came back to Antioch and they gave them a report. So Antioch was developed as a base. But then thirdly, I see the expansion of Paul's ministry, and Paul began to function with apostolic teams and Paul's teams, a front line engaged out there, just like a guerrilla ministry that was just going into new territory and taking new ground. And Acts 21:8, it says, the next day we that were of Paul's company departed. See, Paul had a company. There was a group of people that he traveled together with and did team ministry. Romans 16:3-4, he says, greet Aquila and Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus, who risked their own necks for my life. You see in Colossians and you see in Romans 16, you see this list of ministries that Paul traveled with and worked with and was grateful for. And I love Priscilla and Aquila because it says they risked their very next. They were willing to lay down their life for me in partnership with the gospel. So we had collaborators risking everything in mission. Collaborators risking everything in mission. Paul's best thinking. Ephesians is his best thinking. It's the constitution of the church. It's the genetic blueprint of the church. And Ephesians 4:1-16, strong, strong verses for us. I think we should revisit them a lot today. I'm really feeling a burden for an apostolic and prophetic ministry to rise up and be emphasized in a big way. But three things in that passage, I see three things that are important. First of all, divine resources. God so incredibly resourced the church. I mean, he's given us everything we need to be incredibly successful. It says he's given us the unity in the Spirit, the seven ones, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all. I mean, we got those seven ones he's done. And then it says, and he graced every single one he's poured grace into. So we are fully resourced and equipped to do this. Then the ascension gifts. 8 to 12, it talks about the fivefold ascension gifts, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, for the equipping of the saints for works of service. So these are equipping ministries so that the saints can minister and releasing ministry. And then it says that engaged community, they become mature and they grow as a very mature community, very the perfect measure of Christ himself. Now, what I want you to see, though, is divine resources and an engaged, mature community, they don't happen without the middle part. The middle part is absolutely essential. You can't go from, you know, the provision of God and then boom, right down into engaged community. Part of that provision is the ascension giftings of Christ. And it cannot be done without those ascension gifts. Those are here today. It says, until we reach the full stature, until we come to full maturity of the faith. I mean, there's something that has to happen. And the apostolic ministry, the ascension giftings, are going to be vital to the realization of that. 1 Corinthians 4:15-16, for even if you had 10,000 others to teach you about Christ, you have only one spiritual father. You have only one. He says, said, you have only one spiritual father. He says, for I became your father in Christ Jesus when I preached the good news to you. So I urge you to imitate me. There was the missional, I begot you, but then I'm urging you incarnationally, let as I follow hard after Christ, let that incarnation be manifest in your lives. But today we got volume of teaching. I mean, I could go on the internet right now. We're not lacking teaching, and there's so much of it out there, and the volume is intense. And today in our culture, wow, it's incredible stuff. 2 Corinthians 10:13, we, however, will not boast beyond measure, but within the limits of the sphere which God has appointed us, the sphere which especially includes you. So Paul, talking to the Corinthian church, he's telling them that there's boundaries on apostolic ministry, and there's a sphere, there's a realm, it says a metron and a canon, a proportioned off measure and a limit of jurisdiction. So Paul knew that. Paul understood that. Paul wanted to go further, but he knew he had to see the maturity of the faith where he was for that to go further on. So he wanted more. So today we see so many ministries today that have scope and have spheres and have ministries. And we see many, many apostolic and prophetic models. Some of these may not even say that they're apostolic or prophetic, but they are. You don't have to embrace the title to be functioning in the ministry. But Hillsong, clearly an apostolic model with an apostolic father, Brian Houston. C3, one of my favorites. I just love Phil Pringle. Just the spirit of faith that comes out of Phil Pringle blesses me. You got Church of the Highlands with Chris Hodges and the ARC, the Association of Related Churches, planting churches aggressively all over the place. You got Bruxy Cavey. He wouldn't say he's in apostolic ministry, but Bruxy, 21 campuses right now, and he's developing a network of people in relationship all over North America. Clearly an apostolic mandate on his ministry. Equippers Church, Harvest. Harvest was an amazing model, aggressive church planting model. James McDonald went a little funny, but what an amazing strategic model for planting churches. Equippers, Bruce Bunk always stirs me up every time I run into him. You got Cheon, his Harvest International ministry is a great ministry. And you know what? The Apostolic Church today, we exist because of D.P. Williams and all of these ministries, strong ministries, they have fathers. They have people who initiated them, who were catalysts in the movement. Him, California Dreamin' is one of their mission statements in California. We believe apostolic churches, planting of apostolic churches, is the most effective way to fulfill the Great Commission in California and beyond. California Dreaming is a movement with a vision to plant 10,000 apostolic hymn churches by 2050 that are committed to global revival and social transformation. So that's what Cheon's doing with his group of people. Now, apostolic ministry will be expressed in different forms depending on the person carrying out that ministry and the situation in which the ministry is expressed. There should be a dynamic equivalence to the New Testament model that is contemporary and functional. You know, today, 1 Corinthians 14:8, interesting verse, but it says, for if the trumpet makes an uncertain sound, who will prepare for battle? If the trumpet makes an uncertain sound, who will prepare for battle? And I take that back prophetically, talking about Numbers 10, where Moses was told, make two silver trumpets. Two silver trumpets. And I see that as a type of apostolic ministry. Apostles and prophets, two trumpets working together. And you see, they had a role and a function in the body of Israel in that day. First of all, they were for assembling, bringing everyone into an experiential relationship with the presence of God, the unity of spirit under the Lordship of Christ. That's an apostolic mandate today, assembling the camps, movement of the camps. Whenever the trumpets were, boom, they were sounded to move the camps, to take new territory. There's a breaker anointing on apostolic communities, and they come and they bring present-day truth and present-day revelation. There's also that preparation for war. They equip the body of Christ with the dominion mindset. They impart tools. They refocus the troops, and they expose the enemy wherever they go. They go into regions, and they push out demonic guards and take territory. Finally, they celebrate the feast. They are bringing every camp into an alignment with the timetable of God, the Feast of Tabernacles. We're coming into a season of accelerated glory, accelerated miracles and accelerated harvest. So the world needs authentic apostolic function to emerge. It really does. We don't need new structures and definitions. What we really need is Christ the Apostle restored in vibrant communities, his very substance, his nature, and his authority. Missional and incarnational. We got to be taking new territory, and we've got to be incarnational, and that we're establishing the culture, and we're establishing that whole realm of God wherever we go. So we are collaborators, risking everything in mission. Collaborating, risking. I feel like for us, we want to risk everything right now. We want to throw it all at the wall. We don't want to stay in a static position. We believe it's time to collaborate together aggressively, and let's risk everything for the kingdom. We need to encourage creative experimentation, because there's going to be many different models, and those models will be different, and they will vary depending on the individuals and their makeup, but also depending on where God has established them and where they're planted. So apostolic models right now, apostolic and prophetic models for today. Bless you guys.